NetCafe is made possible by RonDiamond.com, the oldies site on the internet. Music and memories from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, not just another jukebox. Additional support comes from the law offices of Ivan Hoffman, lawyering with integrity for internet law, copyright, trademark, and other intellectual property law. And by TechWeb for up-to-the-minute technology news.
Hi, and welcome to the Net Cafe. We're here as usual at the Club I in San Francisco. This week, looking at internet conspiracies. You know, there's a lot of good information on the web, but there's also a lot of bad information on the web. Some of it innocent, some of it misguided, some of it downright malicious. What we're going to do is show you several web information sites and let you decide what's fact and what's fiction. In fact, there are several good sites that deal specifically with internet conspiracies. One of them we're going to talk about right now, forconspiracytheories.com, part of a site called foranything.com, and Mark Langsfeld is a senior editor with that site. Let me ask you first of all about the foranything.com. I hadn't seen that before. What's the concept?
Well, really, for anything is about a whole new way of searching the internet. I mean, people use the search engines all the time,
right?
And they can give back thousands and thousands of results that are, you know, typically poor, or in some cases that'd be okay, but it just takes too long to find what you're looking for online. So what we've done is basically aggregate 3,000 websites that start with the number four, that make finding whatever you want on the internet easier than ever.
So for anything I'm looking for, I'm going to find it there.
Absolutely.
Like so conspiracy theories.
For shopping.com, for news.com, for conspiracies.com.
All right, so let's talk about your conspiracy site.
Yeah.
And go through sort of the top 10, the best sellers of conspiracy theories. I mean, JFK assassination is still like all over your site.
All over. It's, you know, there's more information about JFK Jr.'s and JFK's assassination all the time on the web.
So people just haven't given up on the Lee Harvey Oswald and the Jack Rubies and all that.
People have strong opinions online. I mean, you know, these are people who, you know, can be in anywhere in the world. They can have their really strong opinions of, you know, what they think really happened, and they can express themselves online. It's free.
Right, and 35 years later, whatever, it still goes on.
Absolutely.
All right, and of course, then we have JFK Jr.'s death, and people are online saying, well, he didn't really die, and he's living somewhere else, and that stuff is circulating too, right?
Yeah, just like his father. I think for more of JFK Jr.'s sense, I mean, we've seen less material about the actual death, and it is just the whole mystery behind the whole family.
Right.
I mean, it's tragic what's really been happening.
But I've seen stuff saying he's not really dead. This is a cover-up. You know, he's living in South America somewhere.
Well, and that's really a major theme with most people who die, we find. You know, people who wanted to get away from the fame and wanted just to kind of live off on an island.
All right. You've got all kinds of Elvis links on your side. People talking about Elvis is not really dead.
Absolutely. Elvis, Tupac. I mean, we can go through, you know, the Princess Di.
Yeah.
You know, these people have mysteriously died and are hiding away somewhere else in the world.
And all these people are spreading these stories on the web. What is the psychology you think here? I mean, why are people driven to not believe what's out there?
I think on the web, what you have is an environment where people can put up anything virtually for free.
Right.
And so if you have, like, you know, people in all over the world, you know, Zimbabwe, United States, Canada, it doesn't matter where they are. And you know, with you have all this information out there that it's unbiased, it's not typically American, and so we can find these wonderful stories, and people have strong beliefs.
Now, you've got, TWA Flight 800. I mean, that's a big one, too, right? Remember, Pierre Salinger got in big trouble. They held a big news conference saying, I have definitive evidence that the Navy shot this down or something. And he was reading some junk on a website.
Yep. I mean, you know, there's reports that they actually had some satellite photos of these missiles going up in contact, you know, connecting with the ship as it fell from the sky. It's amazing.
And here's a former White House press secretary who falls for a web conspiracy.
Absolutely.
Now, Waco's an interesting example, right? Because for years, people were telling these stories about Waco, and it turns out they might have been right now with what we've learned.
Yeah. I mean, even PBS has a special on the internet about the Waco story and,
right.
and who shot first, and that these are debates that are happening right now in the government.
Wow. What are any other ones we haven't talked about that are on your site in terms of popular conspiracy theories that are still going on?
I think the most interesting one that we find is, I think, more enlightening, is that Papa Smurf is a communist. This is one where someone who obviously has too much time on their hands thinks, you know, really the Smurfs, which is a series that ran in the 80s on Saturday mornings on network TV, you know, it was basically a conspiracy by the Russian government that they were trying to instill, communist belief in Western society.
Now, I mean, that's sort of one of the underlying themes through all of this, whether it's the UFOs or whether it's JFK, that the government doesn't tell us the truth, right?
Yep.
And there's like this big government conspiracy to hide important information from we average folks.
Yeah, really since, I think over the last 40 years, you find, you know, the whole idea that government's big brother, they don't know whether or not what the government says. And I think many people today, probably a good percentage of them, don't know what to believe anymore.
Well, you look at the FBI story on Waco, and, people have have a reason for that.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Now, you've got the Clinton stuff, right? They're the people who believe that Vince Foster and Ron Brown, all these people were like killed by the Hillary Bill axis or whatever.
It's a sensitive subject for us, but you know, it's amazing that I think it's up to 40 or 50 right now. You know,
people supposedly killed by the Clinton
people
mafia.
People associated with Clinton over the years that have mysteriously passed away.
All right, anything, foranything.com is where to go.
Yes.
Thank you, Mark. This is a great time to be a conspiracy theorist with the coming of the new millennium. If you read all the conspiracy theories on the web right now about Y2K, you'd be convinced that the world is coming to an end just because the calendar is changing. Jane is talking to a journalist who's been covering this angle of the Y2K story.
So, Don, you're the religious writer for the San Francisco Chronicle.
That's right.
And you've been keeping track of Y2K, and it relates to religions and spiritual awareness and those types of things. I'm not sure I quite get the link between the year 2K, computer bug, and religion. So maybe you can help me put
it does seem
together.
Strange at first, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But what I noticed was that two distinct religious groups, conservative evangelical Christians and people in the New Age movement, had an unusual interest in the whole Y2K computer bug. And I found that interesting. You know, in the case with Christians, you know, there's a long tradition of Christians looking at the Book of Revelation, which talks about the end of time, the end of the world, the apocalypse, and trying to figure out when that is and what all this sort of visionary, bizarre material in the Book of Revelation is all about. And a lot of Christians were looking at the Y2K computer bug and all these predictions of the end of the world because the computers are going to crash, and then the Book of Revelation and finding parallels between the two, connecting biblical prophecy with Y2K and
It sounds a bit like a self-fulfilling prophecy, because there's sort of long time been people talking about the millennium, the end of this millennium being the end of the world, and then suddenly this Y2K bug comes along and it becomes the substitute for justifying it?
Well, throughout history, people have been trying to figure out, you know, for instance, what is this 666 in the Book of Revelation, or who is the Antichrist, you know? And so throughout history, different candidates have come up. I mean, some people thought Hitler was the Antichrist, or Saddam Hussein, or Ayatollah Khomeini, whoever is the enemy or the devil or the suspicious character out there. Well, now it's funny, a lot of people think that the internet is the Antichrist.
So the World Wide Web is
666 equals www. People are coming up with all kinds of ways of calculating.
So you're talking about numerology.
Looking at the numerological value of the Hebrew alphabet or the Greek alphabet. One guy came up with a system which shows that www actually equals 666. Or you spell out computer if every letter in the word computer is assigned by increments of six. There's a way you can get it to add up to 666. So there's all these people out there trying to figure out how they can connect these two events.
So we hear a lot about sort of the apocalyptic views of the end of this millennium, and we also hear about Y2K and a lot of the frenzy over the fears that people are going to be hoarding and, you know, the stock market's going to crash because everybody's going to be trying to sell their stock before the end of the year. Is there another side to the coin? Is there any light at the sort of
Y2K? One thing I've written about in the Chronicle is there's a whole range of reactions to this. There's one extreme, or the doomsday, people seeing digital doom, you know, in the internet. But then there are other people that say, well, this is a great opportunity for people to get together, neighborhoods to get together, meet your neighbor, you know, get prepared in case something does happen.
So better to know your neighbor so they can help you out in the case.
I mean, you know, they say that every crisis can also be an opportunity. There's a way to look at a crisis and make it into an opportunity or to a positive development. So a lot of churches and other spiritual groups or neighborhood groups, they're getting together and just making sure they know each other, having, you know, pooling resources around water and food and
Idea of shortages.
Just to know your neighbor and, you know, just to be ready for anything, whether it's an earthquake or a Y2K-induced problem or a hurricane or anything.
So there's this link between sort of Christianity far to the right and then sort of these New Age folks seeing sort of the other side of the Y2K phenomenon.
Exactly.
What about other religious groups? What about other parts of the globe?
What you think about these two groups, though, while they do seem different, you've got they're actually both invest a lot of meaning in the future, whether it's the New Age, which is the New Age, right? Something is going to come out of the rubble when society collapses. You get the same thing on the conservative Christian side.
So they're all looking for something new.
So while they're very different theologically or politically, they both see, they almost want a breakdown. They almost want chaos in a way for something else to emerge. But of course, then there's the vast middle, like you say, Roman Catholics, Protestants, mainline churches. I mean, for the most part, they're not all that interested in Y2K, but they are interested in the millennium because it's the 2000th anniversary of, right. the, of the birth of Christ. So there's a lot of interest around that, apart from computer fears and concerns.
Now, they're certainly sitting here on the desk here, and it says Y2K, the digitones. Yeah. What's this all about?
Well, I was writing so much about, you know, digital doom and the apocalypse that I just decided that we needed to lighten things up a little bit. We needed a little humor to make it through all the hype and fears of the millennium. So got together with some musicians, and we put out a parody song about all this, Y2YK by the Digitones. We formed our own label called Digital Doom Music.
So can you download this off the internet?
We've got a website. Before it all crashes, we wanted to make sure we got our website out there.
So, and what's the website's address?
It's www.y2ksong.net.
Great. Well, when you're building your stockpiles, you should be listening to this
song
in the background.
That's right, definitely.
Thanks so much.
Have a lot of batteries so you can listen to it after the power goes out.
Yeah. Great.
For many people who surf the web, the real internet conspiracies are not on those weird oddball sites, but on the mainstream media sites. They believe there's sort of an unwritten conspiracy not to cover certain kinds of stories. To counter that, there are lots of other websites, and two I'll give you for an example, disinfo.com and unamerican.com, and Srini Kumar works with both of them. Srini, is there a conspiracy in the mainstream media not to give us the information we ought to have?
Well, whether or not there is a conspiracy, the fact remains that we are not receiving an adequate amount of political information through cultural outlets such as media outlets.
Now, I mean, there's a sense we get more than we want of this. Now, what do you mean we're not getting enough?
In a way, the editorial ability of the mainstream media is a lot more significant as a counter-revolutionary force than the actual content. In other words, it's not how something is said, but what it gets chosen to be said.
Okay, so editorial decisions are made that leave out a certain segment of society.
That leave out what we commonly term as fringe information, which is the specialty of disinfo.com.
Okay, what is fringe information? What do you mean?
Fringe information includes everything from, you know, how-tos, such as how to subvert a high school, to why and whys and wherefores, you know, position papers on different more or less radical, non-mainstream Republican or Democratic views on political decisions. So what disinformation purports to disseminate is more, is information that will incite people and action.
Right. Now, it seems logical that mainstream media is not going to do that kind of stuff, because it's not really news, is it? I mean, it's sort of activism information.
Absolutely. It is not, it's not my purpose in creating a conspiracy to destroy or denigrate what exists in the mainstream media. It is more an attempt to present optional information.
Okay, so at disinfo.com, first of all, I take it you're not putting out disinformation, right?
No, it's not.
Why is it called that?
It's called disinformation because it's necessary to market the truth. And in a sort of a Gen X, Gen Y cynicism, you know, kind of culture, we've had to
call it the opposite.
Go
as bad as good.
Exactly.
Right.
It's a little Orwellian, isn't
it? Okay. Now let's go to unamerican.com, which is the site you founded. That's really a kind of revolutionary site. I mean, you go on there and you say, things are bad, and we've got to change them.
Yes. My purpose with Un-American is to make as much of a political impact as a guy in an apartment can.
Okay.
The point being, I think that it's our responsibility as citizens to express ourselves as vigorously as possible, especially when we see something of which we're critical.
Yeah. Now, most people think things are just great now. Everybody's making a lot of money, society is wonderful, blah, blah, blah. And you're out there saying, no, things are terrible, and we've got to change things. Well, I mean, are you a revolutionary? I mean, would you go out and, you know, get a gun if you could and change things?
It's not about violence ever, really. I mean, the idea that there could ever be a coercive overthrow of the United States government is to me, absurd.
That's over.
Exactly.
Okay.
And so
my
revolutionary goal has nothing to do with, you know, rebooting just the political and social structure. I kind of want to play with people's minds a little bit and have them learn ways of using the existing system to their benefit.
So is it kind of a values issue? You think maybe the wrong values are put up on a pedestal and we don't have the right values in a sense?
I do, and I think one of the reasons I'm in the Silicon Valley and pushing this kind of a philosophy is that I see a lot of kindred spirits within the web world. A lot of people are starting their own businesses, turning their own sites into community focuses.
Changing the rules.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. And community has been one of the things that has been destroyed in the last 50 years of mainstream media. And I'd like to see it come back, and the web is arriving just in time.
That's for sure. Now, on American.com, you sell stuff there, right? I mean, that's the business you're in.
Absolutely.
What, sort of like radical posters, radical bumper stickers?
Yeah, it's stickers, T-shirts, postcards, pins, anything I can put a message on.
And what kind of messages?
Well,
without using bad language.
Well, fundamentally, we sell the truth in 10 words or less. We deliberately choose media such as T-shirts, stickers, et cetera, where you can't exactly just ramble on and on.
And what a typical message would be?
Well, Whitey Will Pay is a typical
what are your best sellers?
Well, Reboot America is a very popular one. People Before Profit. And we also have more off-color stickers for a non-television audience.
All right. All right, so on these two sites again, what do you hope to ultimately accomplish? If we go to Disinfo, we go to Un-American, you're trying to get me to do what?
Well, think of the web and the internet as the greatest gift in the world to anybody who wants to start a conspiracy. Okay, we have things like encryption, we have universal access, we have timed release programs that can put out web content on
But your conspiracy schedule is designed to ultimately accomplish good.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Right, Trini,
it's sort of
you.
Like making white blood cells out of individuals. Okay.
Some of the false stories on the web are actually spread by pranksters who just want to have a lot of fun and use the power of the internet to do so. A lot of time, these stories are called urban legends. And Jane is talking with a man who specializes in exposing urban legends. His name is David Emery.
David, you're the folklore guide at About.com. And, well, we're talking about urban legends. Mm-hmm. And I guess my first question is, how do you define an urban legend?
Well, there's a lot of misinformation on the internet. You have internet hoaxes, you have rumors, and you have urban legends. What's different about an urban legend is that it's a story. There are traditions of telling legends that go back thousands of years. In fact, people have always told legends. And an urban legend is a modern story that's usually about one person, something happened to one person, or maybe a family. You hear it from a friend of a friend who claims that they know the person
right.
that's really happened to. And it's a story. It has a beginning, middle, and an end, and often there's a moral message to it. And the way that's different from a hoax or a rumor is that hoaxes might just be warnings about some hazardous substance that might kill you.
Or a virus on
right.
the computers.
Yeah,
or
and a rumor might just be that such and such a star has some strange sexual habit or, you know.
They all do, don't they?
No. I thought so.
So now, what would be an example? What would be one of your favorite urban legends, since you are the authority on urban legends?
Well, my favorite, and really this is most people's favorite, because I found that almost everyone has told this and believed it at one time or another, is the legend of the kidney snatchers.
Yes.
And this story, the way it's told these days is that there's a student in Austin, Texas, who goes to a party one night, has too much to drink, does some drugs, meets a woman he's never known before, and goes home with her, passes out, and wakes up the next morning, and both of his kidneys are gone. He's lying in a bathtub full of ice. He's bleeding, he's got big scars on his back, and there's a message written on the mirror in lipstick that says, dial 911, your kidneys are gone.
Sounds a bit far-fetched, though.
Yes, and supposedly the kidneys have been sold on the black market, and as far as we know, this has never happened. There's some talk in foreign countries about organ-snatching rings, but this is always done in clinics, and it's by doctors who are taking money under the table or something, and so they have the appropriate setting to do this in. But it's virtually impossible to surgically remove somebody's kidneys without a staff of
right.
Qualified personnel around. So,
what do you think the bigger lesson to this? I mean, you've got a philosophy background, and obviously there's got to be something behind all of these urban legends, and this one in particular. What do you think the bigger message is here?
To tell you the truth, I think it's about fear. Urban legends tend to tell us what we're afraid of, and oftentimes what we're afraid to talk about. The apparent moral of this story is don't go out drinking and take drugs and go around strange people. But really, it's about how all of us are kind of afraid of strangers. And we don't really trust people we don't know. And often the story is told about travelers in a foreign country or a city they've never been in. So
right.
it's that, you know, urban legends express our deepest fears.
Well, it's interesting because as I went to about.com and I went to a couple of the other, you know, the other sites that talk about urban legends, I was reading down through a few of them, and I've told some of these stories and really believe that this really happened. I felt like a bit of a dodo, to be honest with you, but you know, cow tipping, and what was the other one? The scuba diver that was dropped in the middle of the forest and he was burnt to death, and you
know, that's right.
All of these things. So it's how does this happen that you buy right into it and then you go to your site and it's all debunked and it's not real.
Yeah, well, I must confess I've done it too. 10 years ago, I heard the kidney story, and I was telling everyone I knew because I believed it. I think human beings just love stories. And we kind of wish that life would unfold like a story. And our lives don't. I mean, you know how real life goes.
Right.
Especially there's no good ending. Like even relationships or you name it, family matters. Things blow up and then they kind of just dwindle out and, you know, there's nothing satisfying about it. But we wish that life would be like a story. And so when we hear these great stories, like the frogman dropped out of a helicopter into a forest fire, and his charred remains are found
later. They're so complete.
Yeah, they're complete, and they make us feel good in the telling.
So if we go to the about.com section on urban legends, there's just a wealth of information, some to surprise, and some for just a great giggle. It's a great website and a great column. Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
One of the real fertile areas for conspiracy theories on the web is this whole business of UFOs and aliens and alien abductions and Roswell autopsies, etc. But one of the more respectable sites that covers this territory is a site called thewordistruth.org, put up there by Joe Firmage, a very interesting character. Joe wasn't able to make it here today, but we do have Michael Fitzgerald, who's an editor with ZD Newsnet, and you've covered the story and you've interviewed Joe, so we're just going to kind of pick your brain if we can here. First of all, tell us the story for people who don't know Joe's interesting background.
Well, Joe Firmage has been actually in the computer business for quite a while. He started a software company called Sirius back in the early 80s, which he sold to Novell for a hefty sum of money. Eventually got into the web side of things, founding US Web, which merged with CKS. And then it sort of came out that, Joe believed in things like technology transfer from extraterrestrials, among other things, and so the company decided that, and he decided that maybe he should part ways with them, and so he's off running his own sort of venture capitalist, and that's kind of where we get to.
Now let me ask you about Joe. This guy is obviously smart. He's a techie. He's made a lot of money. He's a good businessman. Is he a wacko, or is he a credible guy to tell these stories of having dinner with aliens?
They could look at him as our generation's Copernicus in the future, for all I know. He's not a wacko. The extraterrestrial stuff, when you interview him face-to-face, he tends to, at least with me, he tended to couch that a little bit less emphatically than he has in some other interviews or in his book. But what he's really positing here is that, you know, there could be people from outer space who have come down here and given us technology transfer. At various points, he's come out somewhat strongly against the idea, or somewhat in favor of the idea that the Roswell incident really happened.
Right.
But a lot of that's only a piece of what he's really trying to do with the Word is Truth.
Let's talk about the site for a minute. So, thewordistruth.org. I mean, it's a massive website. That's kind of a book online, right?
Yeah.
What's sort of the bottom line message on that site?
Well, I mean, the bottom line message is that he believes we're in a period of evolutionary change, which is going to see us come to huge leaps in our understanding of the physical sciences, primarily through radical new physics, of our historical role, of where religion plays into our lives. So it's more than just technology, it's society. You know,
but he and the site, I mean, you mentioned it before, just talk about this possibility of technology transfer from aliens, from other planets or something. What is that about?
Well, what he's doing there is he's basically positing that this Joe had an event happen at some point in his life when he was a younger man.
He claims he was in bed or something, and his alien showed up in the middle of the night and talked to him.
And they talked to him, and one of the things they talked about was the possibility of space travel and how it could happen for him. So he believes that we're going to come to a whole new understanding of the laws of gravity, in part through things that we understand now, and in part through things like the transistor that he has argued in some places were given to us, or the ideas were given to, you know, the so-called inventors of these from extraterrestrial contacts that have been covered up.
Now, there are a lot of folks out there who say, Joe is nuts, this is crazy, we haven't stolen the transistor from some alien.
Right.
How do you bring these two points of view together? They're both credible, smart people who have the opposite views.
Well, Joe, I mean, what you do if you're looking at what Joe Firmage is saying is he really does try to couch this carefully and say that possibly this is a possibility.
Okay.
Maybe this
okay.
is how it happened. How else will we come to these ideas on our own? You know, and it just depends on where you sort of twist it from there and what kind of mood you catch.
Briefly, let me just say about the web in general. I mean, this is fertile ground for rumors and conspiracy theories and so on. Does this sort of further people talking about crazy ideas, if you will?
I think that you can argue that the internet clearly creates more information for people to get to of all sorts of things that are maybe out of the mainstream.
Yeah.
And I don't know that that's necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah.
You know, if it furthers it and it creates some changes of the sort that didn't happen in the Middle Ages as rapidly as they could have, you know, is that bad?
Real quick, your personal beliefs?
Am I on Joe's side? I doubt that we got technology from aliens.
Okay.
Whether there is extraterrestrial life, you know, I haven't personally met it, but I wouldn't say
it's information on the web about it.
It's a big universe.
Michael, thanks a lot.
All right.
That's our look at conspiracies on the internet. Some rather interesting stuff. Thanks to the folks here at Club I in San Francisco for letting us hang out again, and I hope we'll see you here next time at the Net Cafe.
NetCafe is made possible by RonDiamond.com, the oldies site on the internet. Music and memories from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, not just another jukebox. Additional support comes from the law offices of Ivan Hoffman, lawyering with integrity for internet law, copyright, trademark, and other intellectual property law. And by TechWeb for up-to-the-minute technology news.
To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.